Hey, and welcome back to Release Radar. I'm Chris Biscardi, and today we're talking about Rust for Windows 0. Wait, that's not the right version. Just give me a sec here. Gonna make a quick little, yeah, there we go. And today we're talking about Rust for Windows 0.10. Rust for Windows is a Rust language projection built on top of a generation pipeline that results in a Rust crate that we can use to access and use the Windows APIs. The process goes something like this using this Win32 metadata project. You scrape some C headers, we create Windows metadata files, and those get converted into Rust. So, I mean, it's a binding to the set of Windows APIs that already exist. So you're either here because you know what those are and you want to work with the Windows platform, or you're here because you don't know anything about Windows and APIs. And we're going to talk a little bit about how the bindings are work and how you can use them. So this is a fully running example of the Windows APIs. You can see that right off the bat, we have a couple of idioms that don't really exist in the rest of the crate ecosystem. For example, the casing of message box A, which is a function, is in title case as opposed to snake case like you might expect. The other thing to notice is that these bindings come in with this really long, fully qualified path. This is actually really good because what it means is that we can take that and Google for it and find the Windows APIs and the documentation for them so that we can learn what they are and how to use them. This is important because if we go check the documentation for the message box A that we were just looking at, it doesn't include any description, examples, or how to use it at all, really. So if you're not familiar with Rust, using the Windows APIs is going to be tough. That said, we do have a fully working Windows program here. In this case, we create a message box A, pass in a couple arguments that we need to, and then debug the result that we get back. If we run this, we see Annie, are you okay? And if we click okay, or if we click the X, we get the same result back. So I'm not really sure what this result means, and I would need to go look it up. Notably, this project is made up of two crates. Before we move on, I do want to mention two other aspects of this program. One is that the Windows crate exports a result type that we can use for the return types wherever we're using Windows APIs. The other is about the Win32 APIs. This message box A that we just popped up came from the Win32 set of APIs. There are other UI components in the Windows APIs that we could have used instead that are more modern. But because we've chosen to use the Win32 APIs, message box A is actually an unsafe function, which means that we can only use it in an unsafe block. Overall, this project is set up into two different crates in a workspace. Now, eventually what I want to turn this into is display capture so that when I play video games, we can capture the frames. So I've called my binary cap, and that's the main.rs that we're looking at right now. The other crate that we have is called bindings, and bindings is a library crate with a build.rs. You can see in cargo.toml for the library crate, we depend on Windows, and also our build depends on Windows. Looking at lib.rs, we can see that there's a macro here from the Windows crate called include bindings, but we don't pass anything to it and we don't get anything back and there's no exports in this file. So it's a little bit of boilerplate that we have to write, but we don't actually do anything with this. It will generate the exports that we need in our cap application when we build it, which coincidentally is also why it's in a separate crate, because different crates can get cached separately. So if we don't use any new APIs, this bindings crate doesn't have to rebuild. And finally, in build.rs, which is our build process, we can see the Windows build macro, as well as the imports that we were using in our main application. This macro takes the long module pass that we were looking at before, and then automatically generates everything that we need when we build this crate. Instead of explicitly specifying all of the exports, we could use stars here as well. I've found that when talking with people who are unfamiliar with these APIs, that explicitly importing them is easier for them to read, while using stars is easier for me to write. This is especially true if you end up using a lot of bindings, where you end up having a lot of stars in this use clause. If you do end up having a lot of stars in this use clause, it may not be clear which functions are coming from which module. If we turn on the Rust Analyzer inlays, we can see that this result is a message box result, but it's not actually a result type. We also have four different arguments here of completely different types. This is an option type, these are two string slices, and then we have the MBOK enum. If we hover over message box A for a second, since I'm in VS Code, we can see a slightly squished version of the types. And if we go back over to the browser and look at the docs, we can see that each of the arguments is an interparam impl. This is a specialized version of the into trait in Rust that is generic over the lifetime and the type that we're going to convert into. These interparam types are super useful because it means that we can use things like string slices to convert into a PSTR, which is a pointer to a string, instead of having to convert to that ourselves in our application code. This cleans up our application code and passes the responsibility for figuring out whether what we're passing in can be, and also the mechanics of how to convert it into a PSTR. There are a number of different APIs here, and like it said in the announcement, this allows us to call Windows APIs from the past, the present, and future APIs. That means that some of the APIs here are APIs that we may not want to use if we're targeting modern operating systems. We'll come back to these deep module paths because we can just select them and search the web, click on the first result, and then we get the message dialog class documentation, which is more comprehensive than the documentation we currently have on crates.io. In this case, we can see this is a Windows 10 API, what the API contract is for it. And if we read enough, we can see these remarks as well, and that we should only use a message dialog when we're upgrading a universal Windows 8 app that uses message dialog. Otherwise, we should be using content dialog instead. So we can go into the search bar in the Rust APIs and search for content dialog. It's here because we have access to all of the Windows APIs, and then we can continue to use it, ensuring that we've used recent APIs. And this is why, even though these deep module paths are somewhat unergonomic, they're also super useful, because we don't have to translate between the import paths from Rust and looking at any of the other Windows documentation. Even though the documentation isn't fully fleshed out, there are quite a few examples for how to use the Windows APIs, such as this one, which is Minesweeper, a classic Windows app. Taking a look at the repo, we can see that there's a bindings crate here. This is a familiar pattern to us now, since we've seen it before. This build.rs uses far more of the modules than we used in our example, but the lib.rs still only calls the include bindings macro. Looking at the main.rs for this Minesweeper example shows us a lot of the modules that we saw earlier. We've got similar idioms in that we're returning a Windows result type, and we've also got classic Rust error handling with a question mark. It's important to note that the APIs that are not Rust related were originally built to support class-based languages, and while Rust doesn't have classes, these patterns often translate into methods. So for example, we can create a new window builder, which is roughly analogous to a constructor in other projections. There are quite a few examples, so I encourage you to check them out. That brings us to a comparison with the other major Windows API crate in the ecosystem, WinAPI-RS. WinAPI has been around for a number of years, the codebase is fairly mature, while Windows RS has been around for far less time and still hasn't hit a 1.0 yet. Maintenance-wise, WinAPI-RS is maintained by a single person, whereas Windows RS is an official library maintained by Microsoft. Given this information, if I had to build a production app right now, I would probably use the WinAPI crate. But if I was building for the future, I might consider taking frequent looks at the Windows RS crate as it develops. All in all, the APIs feel a little bit rough because they are directly generated, and you do end up having to delve into unsafe if you end up using the Win32 APIs. But given both of those things, it was still fairly easy to figure out how to create a message box. And I'm fairly sure that if I needed to, I could figure out how to use these APIs using examples from other languages and translating them into Rust, which I think is a big win for this crate.